Good evening, one and all. Today, our pure FB urology topic is why every urologist should know ultrasound. And the speaker is none other than Dr. Mahesh Desai, sir. Before we give the program to sir, to be honest, when we finished our MCH in 2006, our units does not have, even in big institutes in India, does not have ultrasound at the bedside to do ourselves. This is the first point I want to mention. It is only when we came to private practice, we realized that doing PCN is not the same that happens in your institute versus in the private practice. When you wanted to do ultrasound guided PCN in a non-dilated system, or if somebody injures ureter, if you want, you are asked to do ultrasound, it is not easy. Second thing, a time back when in Nadiad, as a junior, when I went to see radical prostatectomy, laparoscopy, three surgeons were doing, out of which Mahesh Desai sir, Mihir Desai sir, and one more surgeon, I don't remember name, three cases were there. All the three were using transrectal ultrasound. That time it was the talk of the town that transrectal ultrasound to identify the neurovascular bundle so that the laparoscopic surgeon will see both the screens and dissect the plane so that you don't injure them, like nerve sparing radical prostatectomy. Then not only that, aspiration of the abscess in the kidney is common problem where radiologist may not have idea what you have done. Aspiration of perirenal collection. One time I went in 2010, sir was Mahesh Desai sir was called me when I was at the time participating in RIRS surgery. He told that one patient has underwent transplant, then went outside hospital for last follow-up and then came with a large the collection, then most probably lymph collection, then the aspiration was done on bedside with clear ultrasound guidance. Like that, right from the kidney, in the bladder, prostate, seminal vesicles, even as a matter of fact, urethral assessment stricture with high frequency ultrasound, people have done injection of the xylocaine jelly, assessed the fibrosis of the, these are all the various aspects. The most important thing is the continuous gaining knowledge in the ultrasound is difficult. Actually, I wanted to ask sir during the presentation, before that, let us listen from sir how he developed the interest in ultrasound. To be honest, before I ask sir questions, after first time I have seen Dr. Mahesh Desai sir in Mumbai World Congress Endourology, where I was finally MCH in 2004. Then I attended that conference for presenting a talk. Huge number of halls, huge auditorium, such amount of massive, that was my final year. Unimaginable workshops, screens, so many halls, so many academic activities. After that, I came to know that sir is very hardworking and made an institute in Nadiad. Sir, I wanted to know, when did you, good evening sir, Dr. Mahesh Desai sir.
Good evening.
Before I hand over the program, first 5 minutes, let the junior know how each legend life starts, who is your mentor. Definitely you also might have had mentors. I want to know, when you left India after doing MS for doing double FRCS, who was the first teacher who has taken interest in you and made the urology to go on like this?
Well, you know, actually, I did my undergraduation and post-graduation in Pune, Vijay Medical College. And my teacher was Dr. Bode.
Sir.
And Dr. Bode, he was my teacher and he was a taskmaster.
Sir.
And then after doing my MS, I realized that during college, you acquire knowledge, but skill development you require to practice, and then you need to be under a good teacher, and so after, he also encouraged me because he himself was a FRCS from England, and he passed in 1946. So he was, he knew, they said, you go to England, you know, after. So I had prepared to go to England while I was appearing.
Were your parents were in a position to send you to that time England? It is not easy, I think, that time going abroad and studying.
Yeah, actually I was, you know, my parents were well placed, and I could afford. But you know, going was not very difficult, because the moment you get a job, you are already, you are paid a salary. So, but I'll tell you, it was, at that time the thing was not so costly. So I did my MS, and then I applied for the fellowship, this thing. But you know, before you go to England, they assess you.
Yes, sir.
For 2-3 weeks, whether you are suitable or not, especially in English and communication and things like that.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, there was a strike, in postal strike in England. Any strike, they last for 2-3 months.
Yes.
So I didn't get any letter. So I went to Gujarat, in near Ahmedabad, and near Nadiad is my village where my father was. So we went, and by that time I was married. My wife Nalini was an anesthetist. She was my classmate. So we both went, and Mir was already born. And but then waiting and doing nothing, so I went to government department and asked them if there is any job. I thought there was maybe a medical officer job in nearby civil hospital, but they said, but actually my wife is anesthetist, so they wanted anesthetist, so I got a job. and my first job was in Rajkot, and I did that. And I was very happy. They sent me, only thing is, lots of operating work, but no investigation. You know, even if you want to remove the stone, you just do a plain x-ray and then take out the stone.
Take out the stone.
IUP. If you want to remove, that time bladder stone was very common.
Exactly, which year, sir, this is?
This is the 1970.
Okay.
So, but that time I was, went to Porbandar as a civil surgeon for a on a deputation, and that time, you know, I felt, you know, you are doing lots of surgery, and there was a stab wound. I wanted to operate, but people were scared to operate in our hospital because other people said these people are notorious. If anything happens, they will kill you. So I had to send a patient to Junagadh, but then I realized that he died on the way, and then they did a postmortem, and there was only a omental tear. And I felt so sad, you know, I could not exert my pressure. And luckily, by the time the strike was over, and I got this opportunity to go to England. So I told my father, and then I went first on September 1971. That time the war had started, between the Bangladesh war. And then within a week's time, I got approved, and I got a residence program in general surgery. And while I'm doing the general surgery, I finished my primary, because I've not told them I have done MS.
Yes, yes.
So I just said, and they said, and then I appeared for primary FRCS, and I passed. Moment I passed that, they gave me a rotational job in SHO, senior house officer.
Yes.
And while doing, there was general surgery, orthopedic, outpatient, and urology.
Yes.
While I was doing urology, it was fascinating. I never seen a cystoscope before, and of course, when I was in Pune, Dr. Bapat had joined. He had come back from England, and then
how senior is Bapat, sir, to you, sir?
Oh, he is probably
generally.
I think about 7-8 years.
Okay.
Older, and Bapat, sir, I seen a scope in with him, and then, but that's it, you know, there is a only thing.
So and that so, time urology, who was the teacher who made you to come closer and then learn the things and make develop interest in FRCS urology, like that?
Dr. Tuffield. Dr. Tuffield was my teacher in England. He liked me when I was doing SHO, and while I was doing SHO, I got my fellowship from England as well as from Edinburgh, and he took me to another hospital and gave me a post of registrar.
Okay.
And that post I did, where same post, Dr. Virendra Desai was there about 3-4 years ago.
Who is also founder of this
this hospital, and then he had gone back and I took his job.
Okay.
And then I was there for 5 years till 1975 December, and then I came back.
Those 5 years might have made some difference in understanding the, because at your age, the many, some of the surgeons were there in India, but you quickly have come and concentrated on writing the paper and publishing the work. What was that great thought? Like, you are known for first your academic activities, your surgery, and then later on XYZ.
I felt at that time, in while I was doing MS, there was no MCH or any DNB program.
That's okay.
So
sir,
we have to go to England to get, even FRCS was general. After I left, they started FRCS in urology.
Yeah. Okay.
So basically you need a surgical post graduation and then experience. I had experience of 5 years in urology, and
that time you have written any paper, sir?
Yes, I mean, but that was all case reports and nothing. After coming back, we started the first paper I wrote was the inotropic nephrolithotropy.
Okay.
And we had done more than 150.
If I remember correctly, you came back to Ahmedabad and practiced for some time.
Yeah, me, I came back, and Dr. Virendra Desai was already in Nadiad, so I went to Ahmedabad. I tried to get a teaching hospital job, but then I was from Maharashtra, and that time there was a little thing, so I did not get any attachment. But I got an attachment to a charitable hospital in Ahmedabad. And at the same time, Virendra Desai met me in one of the functions, and he said instantly, because we were from the same unit. So he said, and he had come to England. That time I had known him.
Yes.
Since then I had known him. So he said, I'm building a place, so you join me. That time the place was not started.
Yes,
I started my practice in 1976. And hospital started in 78. So 76, I was at a private practice in Ahmedabad and attached to a charitable hospital. And then I promised him that I will join you. And while he was building, I was helping him, because then I had built my place, so I knew where to get a few things and like that. And
but
right from the first
was,
day...
Deshaya, sir, intention was making the kidney hospital or general hospital?
Kidney hospital.
Why he was so... Because he is also...
He's a urologist. He was a urologist like me. He trained for the same. He says there are so many patients with kidney diseases, and we don't have a infrastructure.
Okay.
And you know, he used to work on a Stegon calculus with kidney failure. He used to remove the stone and leave a tube in the abdomen, do the peritoneal dialysis and thing like that. But he said we need a teamwork where we can do it. And he invited all the urologists of Gujarat from Baroda and Ahmedabad, and we started the place in 1978, and right from the first day, I'm there.
And that time, the road and transport was okay?
I mean, road was there. It was a highway, but it was a single lane. And it used to take about 1 hour, 20 minutes to reach in the morning from Ahmedabad to Nadiad. And at night, it used to take 2 hours because of the truck traffic. And so I used to leave my morning at 7 o'clock, and then reach there by 8:30, and then from up to 1 o'clock. In the beginning, there was not much work, you know, OPD and couple of operation, and then 1 o'clock you leave. I used to go to my village, meet my father, and then go back to Ahmedabad.
So your father used to be there in between, something like
that. About 13 kilometers from Nadiad.
Okay, he was happy to join in Nadiad.
He was happy because it was my mother's wish that I come back to Gujarat.
So
I mean, we all were born, brought up in Maharashtra.
Okay.
So that was a his wish. And basically, I also wanted to do what actually my mother wanted to do.
Great. So after that, see, I'm 1974 born, sir. I can imagine at that time how the situation 1978. Who is your first junior who has given good going along with you after that? Maybe around after 10 years, somebody joined with you?
No. See, Virendra Desai was, he was staying there. I joined, and resident, we had a surgeon who were helping us.
Yes, sir.
So there's one, Atul Parikh was there, Dr. Sancheti was there, then Thakur Bhai Patel was there. And
one, madam was helping in anesthesia to you at that time?
Yes, yes.
She was anesthetist?
She was in Ahmedabad. She used to run the hospital as well as give me anesthesia in Ahmedabad. But when we started transplant, she started coming to Nadiad.
Okay. When did the transplant started in Nadiad?
We started within 2 years. We started the hospital in 78 and 1980. On the 7th April 1980, we did the first transplant.
You had exposure of transplant during UK training?
No. Virendra Bhai only taught me. And then after doing about 10 transplants, I went to USA and I was at Downstate Medical Center. And I was there for 2 months to learn whatever problem we had in initial 10 transplant, we were doing it. That's another story, you know.
Yeah, sir. Now we will come back to the ultrasound. When did you first buy the ultrasound for Nadiad in your unit, sir? Because that is the topic of the day. Let us come to that point.
So, can I start my talk?
Then in that case, I will introduce once and then we will go to the talk. Yeah. Now, online is around 156 people. So, we will go for the talk. I will briefly share because when I have seen your CV, it will take 1 hour for me if I go through it. So I can't give that amount of time because ultrasound is also important for us. One and all who are watching, today program is special definitely because most of the seniors, juniors in the country are influenced by sir. The only reason is the hard work, and the only reason is the hard work, nothing else. He can understand how the other person works, and he works more harder. And he writes papers, he encourages the juniors, the team itself will tell. It is not to exaggerate, Dr. Sabnis sir is, I influenced by him much more after sir, after seeing the Nadiad. Like that team speaks sir's hard work and discipline, and even children, the way they developed shows the discipline. Dr. Mihir Desai is one of the renowned surgeon in the world. We have seen him so ground to earth and give suggestions. We have already spoken about his career in the early part of the career. Mainly in 2010, he became department the chairman in 1983 up to 2010. He is also managing trustee of MPUH and honorary managing director of Munjbhai Patel Society for Research in Nephro-Urology since 16th February 2001. This is the important part. And as far as the academic career, President Urology Society of India 2006, Chairman Subspeciality Society International Urology, Chairman Scientific Committee Endo-Urology Society, President Asian Society of Endo-Urology, Chairman Endo-Urology Education Training Site Committee of Endo-Urology Society, Member International Committee, President-Elect Society International Urology, President-Elect Endo-Urology Society 2013. You name it, it is there in the CV. I went 2007 to Nadiad for first RIRS workshop where Oliver Traxler sir has come. After that, in Ahmedabad airport, I decided to buy it. After that 10 years, I developed interest in RIRS, and presently it is because of sir, I am here. After 2007, every 3 months I was there in Nadiad. That time, every 3 to 6 months, one conference used to be there. That is a peak of the international faculty coming to Nadiad. Up to 2010-11, even our practice was less, so continuously I was coming. People used to think that I was Nadiad student like that. Then he has mastered the most modern treatment for the stone disease and developed techniques like PCNL, ESWL, more than 14,000 PCNL, probably the largest series in the world, Then somehow very few people maintain interest in kidney transplantation simultaneously, and in the year 1940 he did his first transplant. 2868 renal transplant have been done at MPH so far. Phenomenal that is, and everything is documented, everybody tries to report it and write the paper. That is another point. And then he has successfully organized several conferences, 750 scientific papers. We used to think Dr. Hemal sir's 300 papers is will be the world one of the highest papers, because sir also used to write papers a lot and publish. This is the one area somehow even myself I am feeling guilty in front of sir that I could write 5 papers now as of now, even though I am doing such good work in private practice. Need to learn from this sir. And he is also examiner for the National Board of Examination, Bangladesh University and National University. Like that, he is Basie Roy National Award he has received in 2000 itself, and he is visiting professor to Duke University, Cleveland Clinic, USA. So many president, he has presidential citation for the year 2012, Lifetime Achievement Award from Endourology Society in 2014. With this, I will hand over the program, because there is a lot of list. If you see, if you roll this also, it's like this. I have called sir 2-3 occasions without saying no. Society of Generative Neurosurgery, AP and Telangana State, he has come for mini perk workshop. Then this is at Nadiad, at outside the room when I operated along with Oliver Traxler sir. I was really excited. Probably two moments in my life. One is this, and second thing, when operating at PGI. These two places I have learnt RIRS and operated. And this is the USICON when we conducted in Hyderabad. At our place, he did lap nephrectomy. On that day, he was using more seizures than George P. Sir was asking. That time, George P. Sir used to come for all the conferences at Nadiad. He asked, why you are using seizure? You always use the harmonic. Now you are demonstrating. He said, over a period of time, I realized harmonic is very, very dangerous in certain areas. Certain areas can be done seizure carefully after doing donor nephrectomy. Then he also came for the another program in September, where I conducted RIRS versus mini perk. Then he did two cases. That time Prabhakaran sir was doing from below and Mahesh Desha sir was doing from above, so called ECIRS now, but that was prone PCNL. I must tell you, that was prone PCNL, very difficult case. Then he has given in front of the 400 people audience. Then recently again he came where Oliver Traxler sir and Mahesh Desha sir have performed the surgeries, and he actively participated in that 2 days. With this, the youngsters love to listen and get motivated by this. That's why I have spent 10-15 minutes of this valuable time. Whenever we are talking to an important speaker, I feel it is a personal program where all of our urologists are watching this. They should get motivated. Nothing comes easy. Going every day from Ahmedabad to Nadiad in a scooter. Then, because this all information I got from the OT staff. Even at 75 years, when I have seen in the Facebook, he has taken photo with OT staff and madam. That is what we all wanted to learn from you, sir. With this, I will hand over the program to you. Thank you very much being with us today.
Thank you. Chandramohan, it is really a pleasure and a privilege to be here on a Pure Urology platform.
Sir.
Let me congratulate you and also appreciate the at this difficult time you are doing the teaching and training work. And teaching knowledge acquisition is the most important. At the same time, the video people presence that serve as a skill development instrument. And sir, this is a wonderful job you are doing it. And I really congratulate you. I really appreciate that you do it. Whatever you have written in my introduction, basically it is not my alone. It is my teamwork, and my teamwork, which it's my teamwork from the all my consultant colleagues, Sabnis, Arvind, Abhishek, Abhijit, Batra, and Patak, they are there, and my resident. And I always make them write a paper. Usually most of the paper they written by my resident or by my fellows, and is a part of that thing. Only thing is I motivate them, I collect the data and things like that. But it is very important. And if you see that all the students who have passed out now, almost more than 100 from the Nadiad, and all of them are a good writer. Because they get a, and that's credit goes to Dr. Bapat. Dr. Bapat and Shyam Joshi, they were our visiting professor, and because of them we could start at DNB, and that's where. And actually, I could attract Dr. Bapat to become a chief of the, our teaching unit in 92, is because when he saw me doing ultrasound. So yeah. Ultrasound has helped me to attract the people. And then he being a teacher made a lots of difference. And he brought Sabnis and Ashish. And
great.
So now I'm going to my favorite topic. Let's do it. Why a urologist should know ultrasound? And you wonder where this photograph is from. This photograph is from Copenhagen. And this is a mermaid sitting on a stone. And that's where I learned the ultrasound and actually for the stone. See, what happened is in 1982, we went to USA, and that's Dr. Virendra Desai, and that was the last photograph I had with him. And a month and a half after this, we lost him in a cardiac surgery in the USA. And at that time, he had arranged my visit to Downstate Medical Center for the transplant. But in 82 in San Francisco, there was the SIU meeting, and we both attended, and we listened to Christian Chaucer talking about the ESWL, and Peter Alkin talking about PCNL, and we were totally stunned, because that time we were doing the anatropic nephrolithotomy, and we had a 95% stone clearance rate and the preservation of kidney function and no bleeding, and then we have devised a cooling system and everything. We thought we have achieved the best. Now here is something totally different, you know, Christian Chaucer and Peter Alkin. And then after that, when we lost him, that was in 82. In 84, along with Dr. This is my colleague, Dr. Mohan Rajapurkar, a nephrologist, and we both gone to New Delhi to attend one radiology conference, and that was being organized by the Taj group of, Taj has started many hotels, so they arranged one in a 5-star hotel, a conference. And there was a uroradiology. So we went there, and it was a really fun. And that time we learned about the ultrasound. And ultrasound was, it was the sonar, it is a sound navigation and ranging. It was used in the Navy to as a radar to check the foreign object. And on that basis, Watanabe, a Japanese urologist, he devised a medical ultrasound in 1967. And the first clinical application was done in 1971. Dr. Holmes from Denmark, and he's the one along with the BNK, Bruhlenkar ultrasound company, they improvised the technology, so that was useful in the medical field. This was the first chair, where you can see this is a probe which goes into the rectum, and that it rotates and then gives you the ultrasound of the prostate. And this is the first unit which was there. So, but this, the one Dr. Gunther, which yesterday Percy Chipper mentioned about him, and he was one of the professor. There were one from USA, one from England, and one from Germany. Gunther was a radiologist to Peter Alkin. And then he taught us really ultrasound, application of ultrasound, how he did a puncture and thing. We were not doing PCNL, but we had heard about PCNL. Now we heard about the ultrasound. We had never heard ultrasound in India at that time. That was in 1984. And then in 84, in the same year, Arthur Smith came to Bombay, and then he demonstrated the PCNL. And what we saw, that with a confidence he would puncture, like Percy said yesterday, on the ultrasound, and then took out the stone, and he was successful in all the things. We become a good friend, and we are still a good friend. And he is the one who helped me to climb the steps of the endourology. And that's where I started thinking of doing PCNL. And I had collected some videos. And then with the, after seeing the lots of videos, I did the first CNL in 1985 in MPUH. I was the third one to do it. First, Dr. Bapat did it. Second, Percy Chibber did it. And then we did it. And the same instrument, we did it. And this is ultrasound. This is an overhead tube. This is Dr. Sabnis helping me. And we did in 1985. But what happened, we did 14 cases. And out of that, four cases, we could not puncture. We had a problem. And we had to open up and take out the stone. And 10 patients, we were successful. But now, after learning something, I said, now we should go and learn. Because then you know your mistakes. And you want to find out the solution. Success is gone, is all right, you forget. But mistake, you don't forget. And you want to improve on your mistakes. So I went to Mainz in Germany, where Peter Alkin was there. And this is Dr. Hornfeller. And this Hornfeller was very known for a bladder replacement surgery, and he was a good surgeon. Unfortunately, Peter Alkin was away, but I learned, I watched their PCNL, and they were doing the ultrasound puncture, freehand puncture. And I thought, after that, I said, I didn't find much answer, but I could see what they were doing. But from there, I took a train and I went to Copenhagen. And Copenhagen and the Harlev is the next stop to Copenhagen. And then I stayed there for almost, 1 month. And with Dr. Holmes and Dr. Ted Peterson were the two person. And this is a building. I will just take out our photograph. This is the building, Harlev Hospital. And on the 13th floor was an ultrasound department. And mind you, in that ultrasound department, there was no X-ray. And everything was done on ultrasound. You do a PCA, you do a clinical sonography, then you do interventional sonography, the PCNL puncture, pancreatic biopsy, anything under the sun they used to do. And then I saw them doing the cryosurgery in that. And then I realized that this is a thing which will help me. So in 86, when I came, I negotiated there only and bought a machine. And I was the first person to have the ultrasound machine in Ahmedabad. And I bought another machine for Nadiad. And this was a probe. This was a 3.5 megahertz port. And a black one is a 5 megahertz port. And here you can puncture. And from the overhead tube to ultrasound, we shifted in 1986. And ultrasound was my passion. And then the probe improved that this is attachment where you just put it. And when you put an attachment and you pass a needle from here, it will go over the dotted line. So you can see the stone here. You can extend the collecting system by putting a ureteric catheter. And then you can devise and you can do a puncture. And then you can see the water coming out. So this is how we started learning the ultrasound. So yesterday I told you that developing an ideal puncture is developing a percutaneous tract that leads straight from the skin through a papilla and a target into a renal pelvis. It is the shortest distance from the skin to the cup of the calyx, but in a line. Now ultrasound has a dotted line, and when you have a sharp needle, and then you have a one side bivalve needle, and that bivalve you keep it toward the ultrasound probe, so that what happens that is reflected and you see the tip. I'll just show you in a minute. And and here was a peripheral puncture. It respects the renal endoscope. That is important. It offers the shortest transparent camel access. It is important how much you traverse in the kidney. Patient may be fat, but it may be straight line, but how much you traverse, that should not be oblique puncture. It should be straight puncture, and thus minimizing the renal trauma. And then it avoids the large intraparenchymal vessel, thus minimizing the bleeding. There is no major vessels in the cortex beyond the calyx. So it avoids that. And most importantly, it preserves the close connection between the collecting system and the parenchyma. Thus avoids the extravasation. And then if you do the peripheral puncture, the use the calyx as a part of the access tract, thus offers the widest possible and a safest working space within the collecting system. So here you start from behind, you want to do a posterior calyx puncture. You start from behind and the first calyx you see is a posterior calyx. And you bring that dotted line from the skin into that cup of the calyx, then into the infundibulum and the pelvis. And then once you do that, you make a small nick and then with a sharp needle, you puncture. And here you can see here, now the moment you puncture, the needle is coming, you can see the movement of the tissue. And the moment it is in collecting system, you see the tip. Now tip is because of the bivalve needle. And here you can see the urine is coming out. And then you can inject a contrast. And you can inject the contrast and make sure your puncture is proper. You may be in the collecting system, but puncture may be a little bit by the side or, you know, as yesterday Percy Chipper said, it must be from the cup of the calyx. So if it is a little different, you can adjust it. So fluoroscopy and ultrasound, they are complementary. So you want a perfect puncture so those to avoid any complications of doing that. Okay, yesterday we talked about the puncture, how to do it, but this is a simple way of doing an ultrasound guided puncture. But what about the ectopic kidney? Kidney is in the pelvis, and how do you localize that? And this is the way we learn here. Of course, previously, now here you can puncture in this patient. The probe itself pushes the bowel, and then you can see the kidney, and then you see the tip of the needle here. And then once you remove, if the fluid is coming out, then you pass the guide wire, and then you start. Now, previously, people were doing a laparoscopic guided puncture for the ectopic kidney. Now, this video, this same video, I showed it in 2000 in a Goa conference, the video urology conference in Goa. Arthur Smith, actually, he phoned me about 6-8 months before. He says, we were supposed to do the video conference in Edinburgh, but some reason we cannot do it. Can you do it? I said that was a good opportunity because at that time we had lost SIU conference in Delhi also. So we were a little depressed. So we said, yes, we will do it. And we did it in Goa. And in Goa, I showed this video. And that time he passed a remark, Mahesh, this is your contribution to the Endourology Society. This PCNL way we were dying was not done before. Now, of course, everybody is doing. So here it was easy because with the probe, you can push the bowel and you can see the kidney, which is in the fossa. You have to avoid the bowel anteriorly and the blood vessels, iliac vessels posteriorly. You find a window. Only thing is, when you do ultrasound, you can see if it's a bowel, you will not see the kidney. And if it's a vessel, you put on the color doctor, you will see the vessel. So you can find a window and can puncture it. So this is the advantage than X-ray. X-ray, you may see a gas shadow. Sometimes we used to do a ectopic kidney, used to do an enema, but we used to pass a gas in the colon and then used to visualize if colon moves with the puncture. Now here is the Chandramohan is a stone here.
Yes, sir.
The stone here, yes, and sir. Then look at the stone in the kidney, which is a cross ectopia.
Yes, sir.
And the collecting system on this side.
Yeah.
I'm sure you will do the ureteroscopy and take it out. But at that time, ureteroscopy was not so good.
Yes.
And here is you pass the ureter catheter, which is normally required. You can distend the sink. But anteriorly, you push the bowel aside,
Sure. Pulled
it, and you can see that kidney. And once you see kidney and a collecting system, and here we did with a micropore. So we are puncturing at this time, we are seeing where we are going. And we wanted to avoid. And here is a micropuck and we have punctured that kidney. And then the fluid came out. And then here, you like to see, make sure that the position is correct. And then we passed the telescope. And now we can see, this is a micropuck. And then you can see the stone. You can see the stone, and with the laser, we could break the stone completely. And here the stone completely. Now, this micropart, this was done by Sabnis. So everyone who were doing in our place started learning ultrasound, and everyone with the confidence can do the puncture anywhere in the body, so long as it is seen properly on the ultrasound. Now here is a post-op picture. This is another stone in the pelvic kidney, but look at this, look at the collecting system all facing medially, and it was going to be difficult. So here what we did, the same thing, we passed a ureteric catheter, distended the thing. And here I would like to show you, ultrasound is where it can show you where you can puncture. And this is the macro part where you can see where you are going. And you would like to make sure that you puncture into the calyx, little anteriorly or posteriorly, wherever. And once you are there, you can see here that the system is seen. And if blood is seen, you withdraw it until you find your place properly. Now you are inside. And once you go inside, you see a stone. You see a stone, and here you can see you are seeing the stone on the X-ray. You've done ultrasound guided puncture. At the same time, you can see, and then you can do the laser. So you have a three way to confirm that you are going in the right path. You are not trying to damage. See, at this time of doing this, you are not thinking about the success. You are thinking about how to avoid complication.
Yeah.
I don't want to puncture bowel. I don't want to puncture the vessel. I don't want to only puncture the kidney, and that's the stone. And that here is a micropurk. It's a 16 gauge needle. You puncture 16 gauge needle anywhere in the body, even a heart, nothing will happen.
Yeah, I agree.
So this is how we did it, and then it is completely clear. Now, what about pediatric? I know you are doing lots of pediatric ureteroscopy, and I still wonder how you do that pediatric ureteroscopy, because it is difficult. A small, highly mobile kidney, you know, for a PCNL, small compact collecting system, effect on growing kidney. If you puncture and dilate, what will happen to parenchyma? And the instrument that time was large. Now, for example, this is a stone in the pelvis, lower calyx, and the lower calyx. The lower one, you can do it with a ureteroscopy and all that. But yes, the pelvis and this one, maybe you can do it, Chandramohan. And I know I've seen your some of the video and can do it. But look at the collecting system. Or crowding. There's a crowding of the collecting system, and then you want to go exactly there. So this is how I used to do. Put a two bolster, abdomen is free, so the anesthetist is happy, and all the bowels comes down. Here you can see the kidney. You can see the dilated collecting system. And you see the tip. Perfect. You are in the plane with the stone, and you got it into the on the first line, and then the urine coming out. You put a guide wire, and then you dilate the track. And then that time the lithoclasts became, we asked them to make a pediatric lithoclast. So from a small scope, we can pass it, and with a suction, and here with a stone which is broken, which you can see that vision is clear. That means there was no damage to the vessel, you know. And stone is broken. Some of the stone we picked it up, and then some of the dust was there, and dust also needs to be cleared, especially in children. So we just brought the probe inside, flushed with the suction tube, and then we passed inside. And so so suction yesterday, the last part, Percy Chipper was talking about suction, and I think the suction, I favored it right from the beginning, that you need a suction to suck out all the small fragment, otherwise you will fail. And then you have done it, and then small child, we put a small nephrostomy tube to be on the safe side. Safety is always first. I always think about the safety. And then there was not much extravasation. And here is the tube. And in the evening, you look at the patient. We went for the round, and here is playing, you know, totally playing around and without any discomfort. So here sometime, if your patient is some reason you want to do a supine PCNL, the kidney is dilated, and collecting system is very easy to puncture. And here we just did a supine PCNL in a little obese patient, and here the fluid comes out. You inject grossly dilated system easy, and you just put a dilated, put a PCN, and the stone was clear. Another obese patient like this, you know, and then he had a multiple stone. And this is the pressure. So if you have an ultrasound, you don't have to worry about the C-arm, where it would be, anything. You just localize the kidney, and the kidney is lying on the psoas muscle, so it's very easy to look at the posterior calyx and then puncture. And the one track dilatation you do, and here the patient has got in the same position. You can do ureteroscopy. My colleague is doing ureteroscopy for upper ureteric stone. Here I'm doing a lower calyceal stone. I'm breaking it, and so simultaneously you can do in a supine position the PCN as well as ureteroscopy. What about this kyphoscoliosis? How to give the position, even how to pass a flexible ureteroscope? It's very, very difficult, you know, to do that and to X-ray also. So here I'll go again. Here I did, let me go. Here is the, this is the position I gave, and we saw the stone, and we injected local. And then in local anesthesia, we punctured the kidney, and then we did a mini pump, and we dilated the track. And then you can see the stone, and with a laser we broke the stone, and the patient was under local and he was watching what is happening. So sometime in pregnancy you have a stone, and here the lady 3 months pregnant, and we found the stone. So we did a PCN under the ultrasound, no X-ray, and we could dilate and put a nephrostomy tube. And then after she patient had some urinary infection, we controlled it. And after 4 or 5 days, we thought of doing a ureteroscopy. We went and we saw the stone had come down at the neatal opening, and we just picked it up and took it out. So it's very useful in this. Chandramohan, I would like to stress, we did a one paper in 2016 regarding the radiation exposure,
sir,
complication. When we were doing standard, it was a 0.29 millisievert. When we started doing a mini perk, we started decreasing 18. This is a Stowe's mini perk. But think of the metal of the sheath also gives a scattered radiation. So the last one, which was shown with the plastic one, which gives us the minimum radiation when we use either 15 trench or 18 trench with the suction. And for a micro perk, it is 11. And for a RIRS, it was a 0.19. And here, the as you go down, your radiation hazard becomes less and less. Now with the plastic tube, it is a much, much less.
Yes.
So what I want to say, Chandramohan, is for me, ultrasound is like a stethoscope to urology.
Yes.
So, new patient comes to you. You want to do a clinical examination. You, it's got a pain or something. You palpate. You may feel a lump, or you will not feel anything. The moment you put ultrasound, whether you can find there is anything in the normal kidney, or he's got a solid mass, or a cystic, degree of hydronephrosis, he's got a calculus disease. Functional evaluation you can do by renal color Doppler, or you can do a bladder evaluation. You can do a prostate evaluation. And the benign or malignant or post-void residuum, infertility, you can check the.
I think you have ultrasound in the OPD also, sir.
I have in OPD. Every room has ultrasound. When the resident comes to us, for first 15 days, he learns ultrasound.
Okay.
And here is an OPD only. Patient comes to you, examine, and moment after examination, you only the same table, I put ultrasound and I find there is a small tumor. And it looks like I can do a partial. And here is a PUG obstruction. Or here is a patient has got a 1 minute. Patient has got a stone. And I can also check that time. Can I do the PCNL or not? How should I do it? I can assess it. Here is a polycystic kidney. Here is an adrenal mass. So nicely seen. And here is a Stegon calculus. You can see and margin all the rest of the thing. Sometimes you can see that the tumor is so large that whether it's for a partial or a radical, you can make a you have to do a CT scan and everything. But here you can make your preliminary judgment and you can talk to the patient. And that is the most important. And even if it's a partial, in a small one, you can do a color Doppler and see whether it's vascular or not vascular, where the vessel is and how you're going to take it out. Sometime patient come to us, patient comes with a renal colic. He's got a severe colic. And then we look at the kidney. Now, sometimes kidney may not be dilated. It may be suppressed. And then if it is dilatation, you'll be happy. But that you know that is the place. But if it is suppressed function and you may not see, and sometimes you do a bladder sonography and you see efflux on a color Doppler, then you know that kidney is functioning.
Yes.
Or you can do a Doppler study to see the renal function. Now here is a hydronephrosis. You know that there is definitely a obstruction somewhere below the kidney. I can't see a stone. The obstruction because he has come with the renal colic. Or this is a 7-year child and he has got a congenital PUJ obstruction. You can see that. You can see that cortex is hardly there.
Yeah.
And you know that this is not going to work well. Other kidney is quite normal. And if you see, other kidney is 91 millimeter at 7 years. That means compensatory hypertrophy.
Compensation.
So that means this kidney is working and this is not working. I mean, you make a small judgment like this. Now here is a one kidney where there is a part is dilated. You know, this was like a duplex moiety because one moiety has got a here something which we observed and suddenly it got distended. So it was a ureterostome. So you can diagnose by observing. It's a dynamic study. You know, yes. It is not just a fixed study. You write X-ray, you take X-ray and then you try to read X-ray. No, this is ultrasound and you go on playing with it until you have the full function of the kidney. Here is a whole kidney dilated, and then you can see the ureter is dilated, and you can see the ureterocele. And you can see ureterocele in 2-month baby.
Yeah.
Again, sometimes patient has got a colic, you think there is a small stone, you do a color Doppler, there is a sparkling effect. And then you know definitely there is a stone there. And then you can send it for X-ray to confirm it, but you definitely very confidently tell the patient. At the same time, you tell the patient what is going to happen and what you are going to do it. And it impresses the patient. I'm telling you.
Yes.
It the patient that you will be able to do it. And look at it. You can show the patient, see how big you have got a stone in the bladder. And you've got a big stone in the kidney. You have got a factory of the stone in the kidney and the bladder. You know. And see, when you tell them and you show them the picture, they really get impressed.
Yes.
And they know that this doctor, whatever he's speaking, he's not speaking after experience. It is just showing the evidence.
Yeah.
And then kidney transplant. As you know, we were doing kidney transplant right from the beginning. And then here you can do intervention like a PCN or if you leak, you can drain it. Stricture, you can drain or dilate. Lymphocyte drainage, intraoperative work, I can show you. In a recipient, I always look at the iliac vessel, see that there is a good vessels and there is no obstruction, so I can do the transplant there. Donor, I will see that kidney is mobile, so that and there is a space there, so I will be able to take it out nicely without any problem. And here, during operation, I had done a transplant, but urine is not coming out, you know, not much. So I, on the table, I do the ultrasound and try to look, do the color Doppler, which shows that the kidney is being perfused, but output is not there. See, the kidney has been perfused everywhere, both the thing. So what I do is I do the resistive index, and the resistive index is by bringing here the waves, and then you calculate by arranging your marker at the top and the bottom. Here resistive index is 66. There is some problem. So I adjust the kidney position and thing and check. And the moment you come up good position, like say the normal graph, you should have a RI less than 0.6.
Actually.
This is obstructed. This is 0.87. So you can adjust the thing and the table. You can do it nicely.
Yeah.
Immediately you can do it. So it gives you the immediate idea what has happened. And sometimes you have the problem afterward, the output drops and you find that the resistive index is going up. And you don't know whether it is because of the anatomy or is it because of the rejection or something. Our nephrology colleagues, they have learned to use ultrasound and they do a biopsy. This is a gun biopsy and they take a biopsy peripherally, making sure they avoid the blood vessel and they take obliquely. So they get at least 5 to 6 glomeruli. Get it.
Yes.
And then you can diagnose and then you can do it. And there is a collection. You can put a needle into a collection, take it out, and either find out whether it's a lymph or urine. You know, that is easy. Or sometimes you do the color Doppler to see the little function. You do a Doppler study and see the artery vein, whether it is figured. So immediately you get, here something is wrong. Here is some echogenic material here is there. And we did an angiography, we did a color Doppler, and there is an aneurysm.
Yeah.
You can see the aneurysm. And yes. we did an angiography. There are double vessel, and one vessel was perfusing well in the kidney, other vessel developed the aneurysm. And we have to operate and take out the aneurysm and restarted the reperfusion. Similarly, there was a patient, kidney function was well, but suddenly developed a hypertension. So we looked at the color, and here we found there was a flow was obstructed, and then probably there is stenosis. And then we found angiography, there is the stenosis at the origin of your, it is the anastomosis, just beyond the anastomosis, there was a narrowing. So we dilated, did a balloon dilatation, and then put a stent back, our nephrologists are also interventionists. So they did that, and then whole thing was dilated and kidney was saved. Sometimes you have the urinary leak and hydronephrosis, and here we ultrasound, we can wrong puncture, you know, yeah, like immediately we corrected. Now do the cup, yes, of the calyx, and then we put a dye. The dye is going in the ureter. There is no problem here, but then here there is a leak. You can see the leak, a small leak.
Yeah.
And then, but still, the contrast is going into the bladder.
Yes.
And then you put a guide wire. It has gone into the bladder. And then we dilated and put a DJ stent.
Yes.
And then once you put a DJ stent, your thing is over. And then after a few this thing, then we aspirated the collection of the urine so that the treatment was over. We left the thing for 4 weeks, and then the whole thing healed, and there was no problem. So one day, you know, Chandramohan, about 1796, I had a pain, you know. So I thought probably hard working, late hours and thing. I had an ulcer or something. I did a gastroscopy. The person said, yes, you have a little bit of ulceration. So they gave me medicine. And one night I had a severe pain with a backache. So immediately, that was at Ahmedabad. And I came down in my office and I did ultrasound. And there was a stone in the gallbladder.
Oh.
So in 96, I had a laparoscopy in Bombay, the gasless laparoscopy, and my gallbladder was removed.
Okay.
So along with ultrasound, they gave me this probe. And this probe had a, you put a balloon which can be distended, and you can put a rectum and you can see the prostate. First time, we saw the prostate.
Yes.
This was a very 3.5 megahertz, very, very poor quality. But same probe you put into a cystoscope and you can see a bladder tumor.
Yes, sir.
Now, here this is the muscle, and this is the muscle. Here you can see there's an infiltration.
Yes.
So you have a 60 degrees, 90 degrees, 110 degrees. Sometimes there are small tumor you can miss. And here it can tell you. I'm still using this probe in this thing. So image produced with the truss is no mystery. It is simply a picture of a low power microscopic anatomy of the gland.
Yes.
So here is the Masimori from Japan. He described the age related changes in the prostate in Japanese men. So first one, at the age of 30, you don't see any transitional zone. There is a little blackness, but there is a urethra and all peripheral zone. This is group one. Group two, you see a transitional zone, but margin is very unclear.
Yes, sir.
And here you see a margin is very clear. This is a group three, and it is a urethra. And the urethra, this black is because there are two sphincter muscle, longitudinal sphincter, which contracts the anterior prostatic urethra. That is the one. So you see a prostate, but still the prostate is triangular. It's triangular and with a BPH. And then you see the fourth one, where this is a compressed and it is merged together. You can see the gland is getting a little bigger in the position. That time patient may start getting some symptoms. But yes. Now look at now, picture is still triangular, but it is changing. And here is almost round. And you can see the prostate transitional zone is getting rounder.
Yeah.
And that's where you have a sim. And here is a round prostate. So you can detect the changes occurs in a growing man.
Yes.
And you can correlate with the symptoms. And that's why, can you trust the trust in clinical BPH? This is the oration, Pindamanani oration. I gave it in Hyderabad at that time. And there were three things which we detected: transitional zone index, Picar presumed circle area ratio, and these are transitional zone area ratio. So when obstructive BPH, the AP diameter increases more than the transverse diameter, giving the normally non-obstructed triangular prostate in more circular space. The shape is important rather than the size of the prostate. Now here is, you take this, this does not change much. You make it a circle.
Yes.
That's a prostate, it is obstructed. And then you do a perimetry. This is the present prostate. And you compare how far is away from the one. This is one. So this is the ratio. So here, for example, I give you, this is the prostate, which is Picar is 0.64, is non-obstructive. It's more than 0.07 or 0.75, it becomes obstructive. While this is obstructive, is 0.82. You have an objective evidence, not only on PR. PR, yeah. You feel the prostate is one size, grade 2, grade 3, but you don't know how much. Here you can say how much, and definitely you can say this patient. So sensitivity of this test is 88%, specificity 91%, positive predictive value of obstruction is 91%, negative predictive value of non-obstruction is 89%. So here you, another way is measuring the transitional zone. Maximum area of transitional zone divided by the maximum area of total prostate. So if the transitional zone exceeds 50% of the total gland, then it is obstructive. Now here you can calculate. Ultrasound allows you to calculate the what is the total prostate gland and what is the transitional zone. You know, you can calculate, and then here the prostate is 46 and adenoma is 32. So it is just about, you know, 50%, less than 50%. Still you can treat with the medical, but here you can see the median lobe is which is enlarged. Katie Fu from Singapore, he also did a study, and he said how much is the projection also gives you the idea whether it is obstructive or not. Depending upon 1 centimeter, 0.5, 1 and 2 centimeter. Now here you can see the prostate. He's got some symptoms, but we have measured it. His prostate size is 18 gram, while the adenoma is only 4. So definitely non-obstructive. Don't operate. Otherwise, result will be very poor. You can treat by medicine.
Yes.
And then we did some study, you know, like this was in one study where Gopal Badlani had was here. We used to inject ethanol into the prostate and causes a necrosis, and then you has to open up. But this was not accepted because somebody injected into a bladder and he made a perforation. But here you can put where you want. That was a blind study. This, that here we can use ultrasound and you can put it properly and you can do it. Similarly, the tuna. You know, tuna was a very good. Unfortunately, the company did not last. Otherwise, I found that the one you put in the middle in the prostate, right up to the cortex here, very total, the transitional zone, and use the radio frequency, you can do the coagulation, necrosis, and then you will have the urethra will open up and you will have a good. And this we presented in New York in the World Congress. And here is the way you do it. You go inside. This is the prostate, and this is the two needles. You push it, but you monitor it on the needle, the ultrasound, and you make sure that your needle goes right up to here. And we had an excellent result. Unfortunately, you know, company didn't last, but now they are coming with injecting the water and then doing. The second is aquablator. We did 111 cases, and today it is available in the market in America. It has not come to India yet. But here what we do is a hydrotherapy, hydroablation of the prostate, and with the jet of the water, you can dissolve the prostate, and this can happen within 5-10 minutes, and then you can use a laser to coagulate the the rest of the thing, you know, so that there is hardly any bleeding. So this is the way everything is done on ultrasound, where you measure the prostate, you measure the transitional zone wall, and this is the machine where you feed the data and then tell them how much. This is the probe, and here is a water jet coming, and then water jet goes and destroys the transitional zone, and you have a big cavity. And at the end of it, you can use it in the median lobe also, but you can see the verum internum, and up to the veru you can bring it just in front of the veru, and you can see the water jet. You can adjust the how much curve you have to go, how much this requires, that you can feed into the machine, and the machine will do accordingly. So aqua ablation is the procedure. Of course, it's a robotic thing, and the technique is such, which is ultrasound guided, and you can remove the prostate. Patient can go home next day. It is not yet come to the India, but one day it will come. And we have done 11. Abhishek was actually the primary. Abhishek and Mihir was the one who did the study, and then now it has been accepted in USA. Now, for the painful ejaculation, and sometimes hematospermia, you do the ultrasound. Here is a dilated ejaculatory duct, and there is a calcification. You can see that dilated and ejaculatory duct. There is something inside, you know, which is maybe a blood clot or a pus, and then the seminal vesicle is dilated. And then here you do the scanning, and then this is the transverse. You can see that dilated thing on the right side. And then you do a sagittal view. You can see that calcification. There may be a small stone, and then you can see the obstruction and dilated seminal vesicle. And here you under here is a dilated thing. You can see the fluid inside. You can puncture precisely. You aspirate. You can send for culture. You use put a dye with methylene blue and distend it, and then do the scoping. Then you use a hook. I used to use a hook to in the ejaculatory duct at a verum internum and open up in a intraprostatic urethra anterior to verum, and then whole cavity is opened up, which is this is a stone which is seen inside, and then the whole cavity was opened up. So he's all hematospermia gone, his pain gone, and the patient was all right. Sometimes patient comes with the obstruction, fever, diabetic patient, we find that he has got an abscess in the kidneys, in the prostate. You can see the abscess, and a multiple abscess. So here we punctured the abscess, larger needle, and you see the pus. And then after aspirating, we inject an antibiotic. We do 2-3 times like this, and what happens after this? Prostate has become normal. You avoid. Previously, we used to do TURP and deroofing. Now you don't require a deroofing. You can do the aspiration and then take it out. So intracavitary sonography, I told you, during TURBT to see whether the tumor present somewhere else, and a completeness of the resection you can do. So this is a cystoscopy first, and here is the bladder tumor. And now you do the intracavitary sonography. This is the size. You can see that this is a small base, and then you do the resection, and then again do the sonography to see whether you have completely removed the thing and margin. Plus, you can see here after removal, you can see that resected area. You might go and take a biopsy again, and so that your complete resection is done, and then you have a proper histopathology.
This intraluminal is through the bladder, sir.
Sorry, this is in the bladder. This probe goes through the cystoscope.
Through the cystoscope.
Cystoscope.
Yeah.
And now, the most important now is doing a partial nephrectomy, where you can use a probe which is a malleable probe, and with a forceps on the robot. I'm just trying to make a margin. This is a tumor, and then I'm trying to make a margin how far I want to do, and the ultrasound helps me to demarcate where I have to do them. So here ultrasound will give you a picture here. There is a tumor, and as you go out, you will see that the normal kidney comes. So I'll do the marking, so that I know this is the margin. I leave a little bit of one or two or 3-4 millimeter, and then make a cut all over, and then I try to resect and enucleate the tumor. So this is a very useful tool in ultrasound in the partial nephrectomy or nephron sparing surgery. And now I have done now more than 300. Our team has done more than 300 now, and then you can resect and then you can do that. So the urologist is ideally qualified to employ this diagnostic modality, since he is already well versed with all aspects of prosthetic anatomy and pathology. Mm-hmm. Kunar said in introduction where why we should use transrectal sonography for a prostate cancer, and this is the but then there is an evaluation of the probe. This is a side firing probe, then this is the end firing probe, this is a biplanar probe, you can do it in a transverse as your sagittal probe, and this is a triplanar, you can do anterior also, and this is a on side firing, and then you can do a perineal biopsy if you want to do, don't want to do a transrectal biopsy. And here, for example, there is a small hypoechoic area. Here you can very well demarcate it, and here you can put in transverse where you want to mark it, and you can take a biopsy from there. And what you find? You find Gleason grade 4+5, so that is a score 9, and then 100% of the core is positive for a malignancy. So you can know the how much the severity, and you may have a diagnosis there. And then when we've done a radical prostate, and that's the tumor, which correlate. Very often we correlate ourselves with a takeout specimen and the ultrasound picture which we had before. And that's how you learn to where you don't make a mistake. Then you have a possibility of doing a 3D. Now here I want to know, this is a tumor here, and I want to know whether it is infiltrating the rectum or not. It is a hard tumor on the PR. And here is the capsule. I can see the white line fat. And then I go by the side, and I can see the white line here. And then I try to find out whether it is away from this, because this is the only place where the rectum is very close to the prostate. And then you find out whether it is not involving the prostate and involving the rectum. So you can be very safe. And this is useful in any position in the prostate. You can do 3D, and you can play with it and try to find out the how big is the tumor, where is the tumor. I think in the future it is be useful for a targeted therapy. If you want a small tumor and if you want to do a cryosurgery or a radio frequency, you would be able to do it. The second thing I did was a histoscan, because I was not happy with only ultrasound. So what the ultrasound can take the 3D picture, and then the picture is scanned by the radio frequency, and then you get a marker like a PET scan. And here is a red area. So what I can do is a targeted biopsy. So I want to increase my yield of biopsy. And then you can plan out. So you can combine the ultrasound and the histoscan, and you can do it. Now it is not in, because of the PET scan and the multi-parametric MRI, this has not been popular, but I'm still using it. And I enjoyed using it. But most important thing, if you are suspect, you can do the color Doppler. There's an increased vascularity in that. There is a suspicious area. The margin, you can see that it is a bulging margin, and there's a hypoechoic area. So I will take a biopsy from there, and then it will come positive or this thing. Or I can use the contrast enhanced ultrasound, where I can inject a contrast and ultrasound will pick it up the dye study. I don't have to do. It is very useful in the transplant also, where I can see the vascularity is there or not. And then it uses a suspicious area of a hypervascularity, and you can take a biopsy. And Yang found the sensitivity to be 65%, specificity to 83%, and accuracy to be 73%. And that is a very, very useful in prostate, and I feel in the kidney also, in a transplant also is very, very useful. Previously, it was not available, contrast, now it is available.
Yes.
Sometime in the radical prostatectomy, after the prostatectomy, PSA was high, I checked and I found that I left the seminal vesicle behind. It was all dilated. I aspirated that. There was a clear fluid. And then after that, the PSA came down. But then we had to make sure that we don't leave any seminal vesicle behind. It is helpful in a CA prostate to see the stage. Here the semial vesicle is dilated, but here very white line is preserved. So it is cancer is not extended, but probably cancer is in intraprostatic ejection duct is involved. And here you can see the prostate, and you see the rectum, and here you can see that there is a rectal involvement is there. Here I had given a Degarelix, and that reduces the thing, and after some time you will find that the thing was less. Here is again rectal infiltration, and is very useful to plan out and assess. Here is the seminal vesicle, and in the base of the bladder you see a white line broken. This is a tumor, and this is the median lobe, and this is the tumor here. And if you sagittal scan, you can see the extension here. So this is gone out. You can do the radical prostate, but you have to do a lymph node dissection quite wide, and then you have to give a radiotherapy post. Sometimes you see a very hard gland, you think that it is a malignancy, but when you do a transrectal sonography, it's a calcification.
Yes.
And then you did a biopsy, and all biopsy came negative. And then, so TRUST is a procedure which requires a clinical coordination and interpretation as a dynamic study, and hence an ability to fill and visualize the prostate by the same urologist offers a previously unequal opportunity for a diagnostic acumen. This is William Kunar. I think this is a very, very important statement which is done. Now you talked about the urethra. Well, sometimes if you have a flow problem, you suspect this is a stricture, you injected jelly, and then you do the perineal scan, and here you can see the little narrowing here. Or you can have a testicular pain, and the epidermis was palpable, but it was thick. And here you do a testicle, and you can see the epidermis. You can do a varicose vein, you can varicocele, you can detect by a ultrasound. Even in patient with a torsion testicle, you can do the color Doppler and say whether this is a torsion or not. So many things you can do, and by putting what you feel, you see. Feel and see, it gives you an unequal opportunity. And the most important, which is very close to my heart, is teaching the student. And I can, what I feel and what I can see, I can prove it. It is not that sir is talking out of the hat. No, I'm showing them that why I'm telling is because there's an ultrasound, there's a proof. And all of them have become an expert on ultrasound. And then I have an ultrasound, which is a portable. And then they do the ultrasound. I do the ultrasound, but most of the resident, they do the ultrasound after a PCN to see there is a collection, no stone, how's the adenophosis, it is settled or not. And then we take the ultrasound in a diagnostic camp to diagnose. We are doing the diagnose for the prostate cancer. And we do PSA, Dr. Bapat sir, our teacher. And he used to supervise what we are doing, and he approved it. And this is Rashesh. And this is a Kukrecha, who has been great people who helped me. So you say you written a lots of paper. No, these are the Kukrecha has written many papers, and Rashesh has written many papers, and all the residents they do it, and all my residents they do the ultrasound. This is in Bidra camp, and this is Shashikant. He is now in Lucknow, and I'm sure he's doing extremely well. And but he has ultrasound with him, all of them. As the thing. So, of course, whatever you do, you must document and you must get the approval. And this is the paper which we always write. And this is the first intravesical ultrasound written by Rashid that time. And then this is ultrasound guided puncture beaker without a puncture guide. And there are so many papers, at least 20 papers we written on ultrasound. And then this was the thing. So, and what I want to say, the urologist is ideally qualified to employ this diagnostic modality, since he is already well versed with all aspects of urogenital anatomy and pathology.
Yes, sir.
So for him, palpating and seeing gives you the immediate diagnosis, and then do it. And over the period, I have collected so many ultrasounds.
Great.
And I'm doing it from 1984. By December, I got my first ultrasound, and I'm buying one more next year, this year only, because now the quality of the ultrasound has improved. So many things you can do with ultrasound. And now our nephrology also wants a separate ultrasound in the transplant, you know. So My last word is ultrasound becomes my constant companion, and ultrasound gives me a second opinion. What I could feel by examining, I could see immediately. It improves my diagnosis, treatment, planning, and also could do intervention. It made me more competent and reliable. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity.
Very nice. Sir, we have to take a couple of questions also. That is an excellent talk, giving overview of the ultrasound. Sir, if you don't mind, I'll first two questions may look silly for you, but you have to accept my questions.
Okay.
See, problem for all this is normal ultrasound with or without that. First, let us talk about the stone, sir, because 560 people have watched so far, out of which still 100 is online. You know, all of them wanted to do puncture of the kidney with ultrasound. One corner they will have in that in mind first. Being my wife radiologist, I do honestly all my ultrasound scrotum, sir. That is different issue. Transrectal ultrasound different. But when you wanted to do intervention, there are two things, sir. Normal ultrasound does not have that attachment. I'm surprised that in way back in 1980s only you have taken BK ultrasound.
Yeah, had an attachment.
Your attachment.
Yeah,
have you ever thought without attachment, have you ever thought of puncturing the kidney?
No, I can puncture the kidney even on fluoroscopy.
Fluoroscopy.
No,
everybody
see, what
knows.
What happened, ki after so many thousands and thousands of puncture, I exactly know how to do it with that. What is most important, okay, when you puncture, your puncture should be quick.
Yes.
You do this, go a little bit. There are two things. One is
respiration.
And secondly, the tissue resistance of each layer is different. First, you puncture, you have a dorsal, posterior dorsal, what do you call it?
Lumbar dorsal fascia.
Lumbar dorsal fascia. Then you get a retrusor muscle.
Yes.
And, the
Gerotas
fascia.
Yes.
And then you get a capsule.
Yes.
The three resistant will come, and three places you get a little deviation.
Yes.
And you will miss your mark. But when you puncture, the needle is not diamond shaped. It is bivalve.
Yeah.
You bivalve keep towards. So when you puncture, if he's got it, if you want to, you got a dotted line, you know where it's going to go. And there
yes.
is nothing in between. So you jab. And then you have to go a little in or a little out. That's it.
Yes. What are the needles?
If you don't have it, still you can do it. Because you know the general direction.
Second thing is needle. Echogenic lot of discussion happens. Sumit has asked, what type of needle is good for the ultrasound? Do you want to comment anything on that?
Simple is bivalve. But
any serration, something like serration.
Hey, there is a special needle available. There is a groove across, and that coverage is plastic.
Yeah. Okay.
But you know, it costs money.
Yeah, sir. That's
so. And the needle is something which you don't want to. That needle you can use it. So here, if you do a bivalve, you will see the tip where it is going. If tip is going, the rest of the needle will be going there only.
Yes. 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 The thing is, in your routine OT, how many percent, I have seen you operating live 90% of the times with CM, and you have great concept of all the angulations, everything.
Everything.
In your operation theater present, whenever you have 5 cases in your theater, how many cases you use ultrasound and how many cases you use CM? Given just normal, you don't want to record anything just normally like that.
All the cases we use ultrasound, and
all
the
cases
ultrasound. Ultrasound is for the puncture. But once puncture is there, you have to have a CM to see your.
So in your PCNL case,
so
they will keep
minor, minor adjustment. You can do it on CM. So both are complementary.
In your all cases, ultrasound will be ready on the table. OT
always,
OT table.
Always.
Always theater.
Always. We have a 2 ultrasound in the theater. And whoever doing, not me, even the resident, they will also ask for ultrasound.
Okay. What is...
And then you do a minor adjustment on fluoroscopy.
Sir, what is your sensitivity if you have done supracostal puncture? If you do ultrasound immediately on the table, some amount of fluid more than 100 ml, you can easily detect and do something also? Supracostal puncture?
Oh, yeah. If supracostal puncture, now with experience, you
Yeah.
will. I have not put that picture, but you can see the pleural reflection.
Yes, 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 sir.
And then when the patient breathes, you can see. So if you leak something in the water, you might be able.
Subpleural.
Very often in a normal patient, if there is a fluid in this thing, you can put your ultrasound and you can detect the fluid also. But then, you know, when you have puncture and if you want to see, why not put a contrast? And you want a proof that it has leaked into the pleural cavity. See, whenever you do ultrasound, either you can do, and it, whatever you said and done, ultrasound is subjective.
Yes, yes, sir, yes, sir.
And when you want to objective evidence, when you, I'm showing you something, once a puncture and the pleura is puncture, then I would like to show it on the X-ray and the dye study, and then I can show that.
Sir, recently I am doing supine PCNL where I am using ultrasound with little more ease. Do you feel that is there any difference in ultrasound usage in supine and prone? I am not asking that the view will be better or not. That is not I am asking. In terms of the delineation of the anterior and posterior calyces, will it make any difference in position of the patient supine? No.
Because you know the way you like say you do a little Valdier's position,
yes sir,
and then you put a ureteric catheter, inject of fluid, and then come from the posterior, I mean from the spine, you come toward here. The first calyx you see is the posterior. And once you puncture, urine comes out, you integer dye, then definitely you know whether you are in posterior calyx or not.
Yes sir.
So always see, always ultrasound gives you a guidance, but always you double check. So whenever we do the posterior calyx, even in a prone position, once you get the fluid, I always inject a dye. Suppose you are there,
yes, sir.
But fluid doesn't come out.
Yeah.
But you see that you are very near, then I inject a contrast from the ureteric catheter. I just make a little adjustment on the fluoroscopy and I'm inside.
Yeah, you are nearer to the target.
No, let me tell you, it is not ultrasound versus fluoroscopy.
Yes, yes, sir.
It is complementary to each other.
Yes, yes, yes. Only fine adjustment you can do with fluoroscopy after the you go nearer to the target. Sir, in transrectal biopsy of the prostate, I do in end firing, which is as a disadvantage. Will you recommend the Doppler flow before taking every, especially at the posterolateral base? Because in a end firing, you try to go on the lateral aspect and the posterolateral aspect, two pieces you can take with good amount of periphery. Usually will you on the Doppler or not necessary? Like
no.
You
no,
have
no,
shown
no,
clearly
no,
one
no.
You
now,
don't do
now the site firing. I do almost all the biopsy I do on the site firing. And then
yes, sir.
End firing,
I recommend it.
End firing, what I do, this is the prostate. I do the site firing will come, you know, like this.
Yes,
you
sir.
Know?
Yes,
but
sir.
End firing,
yes, sir.
I rotate the probe and then,
yes, sir.
Then I take a biopsy for taking the anterior biopsy.
Yeah, okay.
The end firing is for taking anterior biopsy from the base and from the apex. So you rotate and bring it like that. End firing is good for a cervical biopsy. You know, uterine, you know, you can do cervical biopsy. So
not, you all do only
for
side firing.
Perineal biopsy, you do the end firing.
Yes, sir. Even apex also a little bit end firing is advantage, but you use usually side firing always in ultrasound.
In side firing, I most of the time because the peripheral zone is there, and I want
yes,
to keep from the peripheral zone inward. So all almost 12 biopsy I take from the side firing, and four biopsy usually from
right firing,
the
anterior zone. Yes, sir. I got the point. This sonographic ultrasound, is it much clinical use? First time I am seeing endoluminal through the cystoscope showing the is it in uses or it is only for academic?
It is there. This probe has come in 1986. I am using it from 86, and I am fond of it, so I use it. But nowadays, see what I used to do previously, whether you have taken a muscle or not, how much whether it's infiltration or not. That, but now there are so many other things that has come.
In esophagus, it is one of the top class modality. I heard similar thing you have shown today, endoluminal ultrasound. Yeah. I thought it is rectum, but through the bladder it is visible so much.
Yeah.
You have to rotate 360 degrees to see all parts of the wall.
The probe is moving.
Probe is moving.
Rotating. Like a continuous. Radar. Yeah.
Yeah, radar. I got the doubt. Okay, sir. That's okay. Sir, I don't have any more knowledge to ask you also the questions. I will stop at it. I really thank you very much, sir, for being with us and encouraging so many juniors. I know people will think how your brain thinks, how your intellect to have this much knowledge, because any conference you attend, the way you address the audience as well as the colleague specialists, and then you have got so much knowledge, it's commendable, sir. Really commendable.
Can I ask you one question?
Yes, sir.
Chandramohan, we use one finger for diagnosing cancer prostate?
Yes, sir. Two finger.
Urologist uses a one finger.
One finger.
Gynecologist use two finger.
Okay.
Why?
I don't know, sir.
Second opinion. So we use a second opinion, ultrasound.
Ultrasound, that's great.
That gives you second opinion. What you see, what you feel.
Yes, sir.
Is it there or not?
Yeah.
Is there?
Actually, when I was today, typing,
only yesterday, I done one radical nephrectomy, laparoscopic.
Yes, sir.
And the patient is obese, and he had a little lump like thing.
Yeah.
I was wondering what has happened, and I thought that was probably a hematoma.
Sir.
Because when you put a port, sometimes it goes through the vessel. And yeah. Did a CT and this showed a abdominal wall like this.
Yeah.
Now whether that hematoma is hematoma or it is still bleeding. So we did ultrasound color Doppler, and that found that was a hematoma. There was no more bleeding. So I mean, sometimes there's a second opinion, you get it immediately.
Even in PUG obstruction, sometimes just before putting the central port, it will be easy to, it's useful in this relevance, where is the PUG, and then go accordingly the ports.
Yes.
In the ultrasound.
Right. That we do, when you do retrograde, you mark it out where the PUG, and then you decide where the port is. Now ultrasound, yes. We have not only used, like say, my anesthetist, they use a central line, they use ultrasound.
Yes, sir.
They do now block, they use ultrasound, and they have become an expert. Even our nephrologists, they use ultrasound for biopsies and things like that. So nowadays, ultrasound, you know, now portable ultrasound is available.
Available. Yes.
Which will, you know, for the bladder, full bladder or residual bleeding or thing. It is so useful.
So I thank once again, sir. We have done an excellent program today, a memorable program. I must say 600 I watched online. By tomorrow it will be 2000, I know. Thank you very much once again, all the viewers.
Thank you.
If possible, after 3 months I will come out. I will not tell you, sir. I have to listen one more interesting topic from you. I will come and ask you for that, and we will have one more session with you, sir. Please. Thank you very much.
I do watch and I do enjoy.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Yesterday,
and fortunately, Dr. Oliver Traxler, sir, has given on second half an hour time for this pure session on second of the next month. And Monday, PB Singh, sir, is talking on open radical cystectomy, his method of. It will be useful for the juniors and for all of us. And thank you very much, sir. Thank you for giving this slot.
And I have to come to your place to learn your flexible ultrascopy in children.
No, sir.
That is very nice.
I learned from you. There is nothing you can learn from us, sir.
No.
Thank you.